they live up on top of Carroll Hill, so that's all Twin Lakes.
Okay.
Yeah, that was kind of a, it was about a year and a half later, he started to see her, and son and daughter, well, his daughter had a real hard time with it.
Yeah, sure. And is she Ron's daughter?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, welcome everyone. We can call the Delphi Redevelopment Commission meeting for October 7th, 5 p.m. to order. We do have a forum. And so our first item of business was review and approval of the minutes from our January 20th, 2021 meeting. And so those were sent out earlier this week. Hopefully you had a minute to review them, but if not, we can take a moment and you can look through them.
Mr. President, I review those and make a motion to approve the minutes as presented.
Second. We have a motion and a second to approve the minutes as presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Motion carries. Thank you. So tonight we were going to have a presentation on the hot topic that we've been hearing about lately, which is residential TIF and opportunity zone. And so Anita's going to help us talk about that a little bit tonight. And so we have the map. And we were going to have Jake here from EDC, but he tied up in a meeting. So this will be our kind of initial presentation to get up to speed on what plans are being talked about currently and what may happen in the very near future. So let's listen to Anita.
So I won't say any part they heard this, but the census tract that's highlighted there in red is the opportunity zone for Delphi, and it's one of, I think, 156 in the state, but there are only 49 in the state that are designated as rural opportunity zones, and we are one of those. Basically, an opportunity zone provides investors who hold on to their investment for a period of 5 and then a period of 10 years get very substantial reductions on their capital gains. And it's a huge incentive. So it's one tool in the kit that we have available to attract investment into the area. Certainly some of the industrial prospects that the EDC is working with are excited about the fact that they can build within an opportunity zone and gain advantage from that. Other investors are looking for opportunities to invest in an opportunity zone fund, and we're looking at establishing that so that we could attract. Usually when you sell an asset, a major asset, you have a limited period of time to turn that over, that investment over by purchasing something else to avoid paying the capital gains. And we know that there are a number of such ones in the area that are looking for a fund that they could invest in. That fund could be to support a residential development project or industrial development or other kinds of things that multiple public and private entities might go together to create projects. So that is the basically outlined, you can see that a substantial part of it is outside of the corporate boundaries of the city. So we are also working with the county, with the county development commission. And of course, the EDC is a huge part of trying to attract investments into this area. Almost all of the corporate owners of Delphi are within that opportunity.
If it isn't home.
So it's, I keep using the phrase, but it is a unique opportunity for, sort of for the city and for the county to take advantage of those incentives. Delphi applied for and was accepted as one of six communities, rural communities, to participate in the Rural Opportunity Zone Initiative, which is a collaboration of the Purdue Center for Regional Development, the Office of Community and Rural Affairs, and the Indiana Housing and Community Development Authority is participating in this. We have a core team that's made up of myself, Jay from EDC, Julia Leahy from the Chamber, and Josh Blue from the council president for the county. We have our kickoff meeting with the Purdue folks next week, and it's a virtual meeting, so we're anxious to get started. Part of the process from there will be to expand that core team and invite a broader group representing different aspects, different professions, different interests, areas within the city and county to participate as an advisory board to that effort. And over the next few months, we'll be working with OGRA, IMCDA, and Purdue to work through a process where obviously we're identifying our assets, what we have to bring to the table to for investors, and how best to market that to the areas of investment that are particularly interested in going. For Delphi, it was a portion of Carroll County, residential development is huge. We don't have, housing stock, so if we were to attract an industry to the south of town, as we have many that are kind of on our, that were on the cusp of, they'll be, bringing in employees, and those employees right now would not be able to find the housing within our county or the Delphi area. So that means we're going to be bringing workers in who may live somewhere else. Well, that is great, but it doesn't help in the local area. So that is one of the areas of concern. Obviously, industrial development is a second. Broadband expansion is another area of investment that we're looking at. We'd love to be able to have a healthcare campus. It would be great to have an urgent care facility in the immediate area. There is some opportunity for that. And a hotel, attracting a hotel to the area would be another key area that we would work toward. So over the next several months, we'll be working to develop perspectives that will highlight the areas that we're seeking investment and what we have to bring to the table, both in terms of the assets in the community, quality of place, which we have, I think, a really good track record for, and then also what incentives we can bring to the table in addition to being in an opportunity zone. Those might be things, like tax abatement or help with infrastructure, things of those sorts. So at the end of the process, we'll have a prospectus that we can use to market the opportunity zone to investors. But really will be marketing it throughout this whole period of time that we're developing that, and gaining, you know, input from the community into the process. So that's the opportunity zone. I don't know if you have questions on that.
I had the opportunity a week ago, 2 weeks ago, I guess it was, to actually sit with Jerry White and Dan Skinner at the Locust Board. And they're excited. I mean, Jerry was extremely excited for us. What's a timeline on, from a planning perspective, into the point of time? I'm guessing it would be different, but before you'd actually see investment, where you'd see dirt turned and projects actually popping up. 2 years, 5 years?
I think Jake was presenting to the council for the night, and I think he was saying basically that, you know, if you sign an agreement, generally you're looking at perhaps 24 to 36 before you'd see any substantial completion. For some of the projects that that the EDC is working on, they're good to turn fairly quickly if they got, you know, a signature on the line. For any of the residential things that we'll talk about, the timeline is, you know, probably at the minimum it would be 12 and probably 18 to 24 months as you see things begin to, because you've got infrastructure requirements that have to be in place as you know. So, yeah. Huge opportunity. Lots of open land, all agriculture. So some of it has to turn. And
try to get your hands on it, seriously.
And so we do know that the Ballon properties, which is, you know, where Watercolor Place is and Elmont would be here, is probably going to auction in the fall.
It's been a number one location,
yes,
since the middle 80s, because it already has plotted streets and sanitary sewers and water line in it.
It has sanitary sewers in it, is probably really, really questionable. But one of the we talked about residential too. Obviously, we want to designate this property, which is like 275 acres that are owned by the Vanderbilt and all trust. Don Longworth is the key person on it. Many of you know Bill Bradshaw. He knows the Ballon family and has been in communication with them over the years. He has been in touch with them recently. We've tried to get them to consider selling us separately and not go to auction, but they're really not tied to Delphi anymore, as you know, Andy and others. So their interest is in catching up. So we feel that taking it to auction will give them the biggest amount. We don't know the day that it will go to auction. We've been told it will be this fall, but we don't know them. Obviously, this is a public meeting, but we don't have a lot of detail on this. One of this is zoned as urban. It's not zoned as agriculture. Most of it is in the city corporate limits, except for the two parcels here and here that are in the county. Establishing a residential TIF, which would enable us to basically the residential TIF, offers some advantages in that, we could, provide planning for the space. We could also, provide incentives for developers. We give, the TIF district the opportunity to bond for infrastructure if needed. And to do a, basically a planned development rather than what has been happening, which is, you know, selling off down to 30 acres here for homes along Riley Road or plots along Riley Road there. So without that planning piece, you know, you could have a developer come in and put plop down and houses in an area that ruins your potential to develop it in a meaningful way. So, that being said,
who are you talking to from a, I see Matt Epperly is, on here later on to invite him in. Is it from a financial standpoint, is he the one that you're talking to from a financial standpoint on the rural TIF?
Matt Epperly at Barnes and Thornburg will go to, so the legal, setting up, you know, the TIF district, just as we did the Delphi TIF district back in 2011-12, that would be, you know, the more on the legal side, Barnes and Thornburg, I think, is who you're talking with on that. Is that correct, Shannon?
Yes.
And then, from a financial standpoint, it would be Baker Tilly.
There's not a lot of those residential TIFs that have actually.
There aren't a lot that have been designated.
Barnes and Thornburg are the ones in the book.
Yeah, but we have, we do know that this qualifies. Yeah. There are certain guidelines that you have to meet in order to qualify to create a residential TIF, and we do meet that. What, in fact, we, you know, the, basically the County Redevelopment Commission, Area Plan, Economic Development Corporation, and the city have been kind of talking about, you know, how do we go about this, how do we get this done, how do we secure the property. If we don't secure it now, it stays agricultural, it'll be many generations before we have an opportunity again to bring this to residential use. And obviously the connectivity that this property has with the downtown, with the school, is just major. And also with the, you know, with the trail system. The Bogan High Bridge Trail is just on the other side of Deer Creek. That will go to construction. This summer will be, you know, another major draw and add additional miles of trail, in this case, handicap accessible trail to the roughly 14 miles of trail that Delphi already has. So what we're hoping to do is to create a master plan for this, this area that shows, you know, what the development could look like. So that would include connectivity to the school, to the downtown, areas for retail and commercial along 200. And by that we're talking, you know, drinks, restaurants, and light commercial. Perhaps adding healthcare campus along Prince William Road next to the health clinic. Those are the kinds of concepts that if we, you know, can create a plan, a kind of a master plan of what the vision is for this. Then you know, we have one better chance of drawing investors. And secondly, getting the type So some of this, for example, could be executive level housing, which we don't have, maybe don't really have any housing right now in the Delphi area to speak of, but if a house goes on the market, it works pretty darn fast. So if we look at IPC or some of the other industries that we have in the area, their executives do not live here. And we don't have that housing stock to attract them. So when they're in getting involved in their community, it's not Delphi. So executive level housing, single family homes, and also multi-family homes that provide a perhaps more reasonable level of entry for some of the workers who might be attracted to the industries that we know are about to happen. Right now, we've kind of got a chicken egg problem. If you are trying to draw a major industry into the area, they want to know where their workforce is going to come from. You look around, we don't have we don't have housing. So if we attract employees to the area, where are you going to live? That means they're going to commute, or we're going to rob them from another industry. So certainly our major industries have to be really happy with that. So chicken and egg. If you bring in industry, it's going to create jobs. That's going to bring people who want houses. We don't have houses. So we have a school system, school age population. Our demographics are not supporting the school, basically. And so we have to be able to attract families into the area in order to keep the school population steady and growing. Those are all reasons why we want this to be a residential area. And with services that will support the community, like retail and commercial and healthcare, campus and something like that. We've talked with a couple of companies about developing a master plan for us, a concept plan, and the RDC, the county RDC, has indicated that they would be willing to, that they would entertain the idea of splitting the cost of that master plan. And we have a company in particular that those who were kind of looking at the engineering companies that could get involved in this. We're interested in a company that has not done a lot of work in this area, in Delphi, as an engineering firm, but they are working on the Wabash River Greenway project that involves our trails, the Wabash River, connected between Logan's Fork and points south. They've been in Delphi for that project. And I know Joe has met some of the principals from there, and they are just darn excited about Delphi, about the opportunities that we have here. What they bring to the table is they do a lot of residential development on their own and site plans of this sort, and secondly, they bring a different group of property developers and residential developers to the table. And they've already been talking with them, with their clients about the opportunities that are here. Our proximity to Lafayette, West Lafayette, to Purdue, make this very attractive. Frankly, the quality of life issues that we have, the school system, amenities on the entertainment side, you know, the opera house, the recreational opportunities that exist, the canal, trails, they're just not for many communities this size that have the asset base that we do.
Infrastructure money that's out there right now is just unbelievable.
Yeah, and.
Danny said that it's over the funding they typically get for Oprah. He said that may end up setting aside and not being used because there's so much other funding that has the availability to get to it for everyone instead of a little mod that would be available. So it's an exciting time.
It is an exciting time. I would like to ask the Delphi Redevelopment Commission to act on that master plan. The cost of it is $32.5 million, so the half would be
Yeah, so we originally talked about a third.
City would do a third of the.
Right, so we had put.
Yeah, the Delphi did.
So we, to see the impact on our budget, we put the 11,000.
Yeah, I remember that discussion, so. And then the county would do a third, and, you know, they're about a third of the road, so. And then the question still is out there too, as to, you know, will this be a Delphi residential TIF? It can be part of the Delphi TIF connection because you connect all materials. And the Delphi TIF district, I think, ends with probably the body works in that area. And, you know, the major arterial connects this property. So there's a possibility of doing a combined city county residential TIF. We have questions as to whether, you know, how that would get set up. So I don't think, until we have the minimum parking order and others, you know, we're not sure if that makes sense or whether it should just be, you know, a Delphi focused residential TIF.
It would be a standalone TIF, though, right?
It will be a standalone TIF. The residential TIF is different. Yes, that thing.
I think overlay, but they're standalone.
They're standalone, but it could be, I think it can be.
This commission would be the entity over both of them.
Yeah, so you have a residential TIF and a regular TIF.
And then you have the regular.
But the Delphi Redevelopment Commission that would be over.
That would be one model, right? The other one is a account, you know. The county, city. We currently have an MOU with the county on this.
But the majority of that with the city.
The majority of this is in the city, just as our the TIF district that we have for the downtown. The majority, almost all of that, is within the city corporate limits, but there is a stretch. Where Man Chevrolet and Dairy Queen, that is part of the Delphi City TIF district, but it's in the county, so we haven't had a local agreement.
As contiguous as they are, I've been thinking you would want that to be run through the Delphi with maybe a county commitment or something on there, but
yeah.
It definitely needs the influence of local.
The local control of it,
yeah.
In the city.
And, you know, if you're providing services and, you know, developing these two parcels, they're no longer, I mean, that could also be an annexation question at that point.
What was one?
Yeah. if we're able to secure this property, then that will be probably one of the steps that would occur. Before you do the developments, but you know, there are lots of Calphus has were, marketing the concept of the residential group, that it will also help us as we're marketing the opportunities. Shows that we're, we have a plan for how this should be developed and what needs it will need. How many, homes at different, housing breaks we would expect to be able to, roughly to, have in this space. It won't be a full, plot plan or anything of that sort. It would be a concept plan of, where you would expect to see different types of development. So, assuming that the, the city would fund a third, the, RDC, the county RDC would fund a third. Question would be whether Delphi and redevelopment commission would fund a third.
Okay, we have the master plan. Would they be able to, help us find a way to secure some of that plan?
But it certainly wouldn't hurt for, the loan would, basically the trust is going to, their concern is, get the largest bank for their buck. So, it's gonna go to the highest bid. What this will help us to do is to bring partners to the table to make sure that we're entity, whether that's through the opportunity zone fund, or opportunity fund, I guess it's called, or whether it's a other type of public private partnership. We need to secure this for Delphi for residential development. If it doesn't happen now, it it won't happen in your children's lifetime. So it's the opportunity of many generations for Delphi.
And it's good to hear that you guys are talking to a firm that has the planning and the connection. Those planners have, when they're planning on things like that, they have deep ties with those investors that are actually building those developments. And I'm getting around all over the state and still know a lot of these people in small communities, less than 15 to 20,000 people and smaller, they're investing big time. Logansport has hit the lottery up there with some investors. The big one out of Indianapolis built the big apartment complex in downtown Frankfort, and they've got some other things going on. So there's a lot of investment in the small communities, and there's value in that, and there's funding available. So this is really exciting.
Yeah, I think it is too. And it's kind of like a lot of different pieces coming together. I think I mentioned to you, it almost feels like Freestellar in Delphi. But we've been working on so many different things for years, and all of a sudden they converge and create just a tremendous opportunity.
So, yeah, well, Jerry and Danny both said that this opportunity zone is like stellar on steroids.
Yeah, it really is. So it creates another opportunity for transformational impact for the city of Delphi and really for the area. So to be able to increase our residential capacity is.
The assets that we have with the funding that's out there is crazy.
predominantly innovative, right? To establish quality of place, not just the house or not just this, but the quality of place in the area. So the plan, the beginning of the plan so far that I've seen is just very innovative and is transformative for Delphi.
Exciting part, I think, about this is for this particular company is the developers that they would bring to the table, number one, and second, the kinds of projects that they're involved in. They see connectivity as they look at this property. They see connectivity with our trail system. They see connectivity with the downtown and the school system just literally across the road. And so their concept plans will play to those connections.
It's encouraging to hear that healthcare is being brought into it. A few years ago, Unity and St. E were ready to set here, and who could be commitment from the council on facility. I mean, that was the next step, was to have a facility for them to start an urgent care clinic type situation. And so I still stay in touch with those people. They're expanding in some other areas. Not only them, but others are expanding in smaller communities. Just start to make more sense instead of the whole region of things. That's good. That's awesome.
So we have any questions? So what we have on the table is a request to make a motion that we would pay for 1/3 of this concept study to be done in the area that we've been talking about, and that those costs are then shared with the city and with the county redevelopment. And that plan then is put together with those three entities for that property.
So is the 11,000 a hard number for a third, or is it
a
third?
It's a third. Of a hard number.
Which is
what, it's
a third. It 11,000 or is it a third?
It's a third. It's a third.
Yeah, so
it's rounded, but it's a third of the total price. Now that, that becomes essentially our first project as a redevelopment commission, which is interesting because it's so transformative. So it's a very good project to have the redevelopment start on. We didn't really have it on our radar in the previous meetings, but this is something that's really interesting.
So is there a hard number for what this?
So 11,000 would be the number for this.
Yeah, our share of this concept project would be 11,000. So the motion you could put not to exceed, right? Not to exceed 11,000.
So, first, chicken and egg.
Yeah, it's a chicken and egg thing, right? Because we can't spend out a budget without, without approval of a motion and a vote on each of those expenditures. So we have that. And so, it is a chicken and an egg thing. So I moved the budget down so that we could talk about this first. If we didn't have a budget, we could still approve it. And if we do have a budget, of approve, then we can still approve it, so.
The order doesn't matter.
Yeah, the order's not, it's not, the statute says you need a budget, but you don't, doesn't say exactly that you can't not spend out of it, or you may move, you can move funds, it's not appropriations, it's just like we could move funds from one category to another, because we had some projects we were considering. I think that this project is a super start for our first redevelopment commission.
It's tough in the infancy where you haven't identified what the priorities are at the time, and this is actually a direction towards prioritizing expanding tax base and
so their interest in funding the project?
I have a quick question. So is like our balance is 20,000?
So our balance is 39,701.
And did the bonding come out of that, or will it need to be taken off of that?
The what?
Our bonding?
Yeah, the 375 comes out at 1720. So there's a legal work thing, and that is another tentative thing that we haven't put it in there so that we can see those kind of impacts in 1 year. You know, let's say we did them both in 1 year, what is the impact on our cash position?
When do we find out what our revenue is for 2021?
So if you look at the estimated, right? You're going to be somewhere in that 21,000 reserve is estimated 21.
When do we know for sure?
So I think there's two draws in the end of the second quarter and then the third quarter. It will be close to another 20,000 in 2020.
By the end of the year.
I mean, but we would really know until fourth quarter comes along.
And you know, the estimates that are here for future years are just based on the existing development that's already occurred within the victim. There are at least four projects that are potentially breaking ground this construction season within the corporate limits, within this district that won't generate anything additional this year or next, but as those develop in that increase in the purchasing and the asset, then I think we'll see these numbers increase.
So it would be the city, the Delphi Redevelopment Commission. Who would be the other third?
So it would be the Carroll County Redevelopment Commission, the RDC. And I'm going to make a pitch to them. Larry Kraft thinks that they will be basically this way.
And how long, when would that study start, that planning study start, and when would it be complete?
So we hope to get it started relatively quickly, and then it will be, obviously, the funds do not have to be
and be secured, but they're not, they don't have hardly anybody.
And it's really about a 2 to 3 month process for them. So 2 to 3 months.
Okay.
So we need to get them started as quickly as